That's what this is about.
No. No. That's not what this is about. You're insane. You are insane. What an unimaginably selfish response. No, dude, you can't say that. Yeah. That's crazy. You know what? Yeah, let's get to America. Let's get to the real goddamn country, okay? Here it is. So, as you guys know, or maybe you guys don't know, Joe Biden had a bit of a bad night. 50 million people watched Joe Brandon fail to deliver coherent messages against Donald Trump. Donald Trump was obviously awful too in his performance. He was just like constantly talking about immigrants. Like literally everything is because of immigrants in this country. Immigrants are doing all the wrong things. We're going to kill all of them, whatever. That was his message. It was insane. But people couldn't even pay attention to what Trump was saying because Biden had one job. He had one task. The reason why this is actually the earliest presidential debates in American history was specifically because there's only going to be two debates, one in September and one that just happened 2 weeks ago. And the reason why they had the first debate so early is because the Democrats thought, or his team thought, he would be able to perform decently well and show the American public that he is not a cadaver, that he is not dead, that he still has like some kind of mental faculties. And that he'll be able to deliver a coherent message, and it will show how insane Trump is. By comparison, it will remind the Americans how crazy and chaotic Donald Trump is, and that Biden is the guy to beat him. He failed to do that. He failed to meet the challenge head on.
It's really unpredictable, though.
No one knew that was going to happen.
Yeah, no, you must be a radical communist if you were to say that he is old, especially if you said it in 2020, for example, like I did. All of a sudden, I guess the veil was lifted and the entirety of mainstream media recognized something that we've been saying for a very long time, which is that, like, he's old as and he's demented. Like, get out of the man. What are we doing? So, in the aftermath of that, there was a lot of fallout. There were Democratic Party donors that came out and were like, you have to drop out, you know, which Holy is a shit. Massive a deal. Yeah, that's a much bigger deal than like sitting Democratic governors and sitting Democratic House members that openly wrote the entirety of the New York Times op-ed editorial board demanded Biden drop out. These are all pretty important parts of the Democratic Party because like all the donors read the New York Times. They care about that shit. So All of a sudden, they're going to look at, they're going to look at their investments and recognize that they're maybe not going to get a return on that investment. So they're going to pull their funding. All of this stuff is really bad for Brandon, but it seems like Joseph Robinette Brandon's instincts were to selfishly stay in the race, to refuse to drop out and just lash out at anyone and everyone that has been saying like, dude, you're 800, just drop out, bow out gracefully. And like, let's immediately put a new person in, before time runs out.
Has anyone ever won being put in late? Like,
I don't believe so. But the reality of the matter is, he's so unpopular when the Democratic Party is ultimately pretty popular, like much more popular than the Republicans in comparison. That the idea is like anyone else would do a better job as long as there's enough.
I just don't understand why they didn't give him more drugs, whatever they're giving him. Why not just try something radical? Just supercharge.
Put a little
man.
Machine inside him. Just control his mouth. Do the whole thing. Like it's
wake him up a little bit.
So, did you hear that two of the radio interviews that Brandon did had Fed questions to make sure Brandon had rehearsed lines? I did not know that, but that's not.
I mean, surely that might. Yeah,
that's
that
not even
sense.
Remotely surprising to me. Anyway, but like for them, this was a massive failure, right? So a lot of people were like, dude, you got to fix this. So what did Brandon do? He said, all right, in a week from now, which was, this was yesterday or 2 days ago, I am going to do an interview with George Stephanopoulos. Okay. And in that interview, I'll show that I'm dynamic. I'll show America that I still got it. He also did a bunch of radio interviews in the process where he said he was a black woman, but it was like a regular gaffe. Like that was a normal gaffe, to be fair.
Trump says that too.
Yeah, like he has those gaffes too, like low key. But the thing is, that wasn't enough for a lot of people who already, the damage is done at this point. Yeah. But it turns out this interview, and I haven't watched it at all. I've only seen like bits and pieces of it. Turns out this interview wasn't great either. So let's take a look at how Brandon tried to salvage the situation with a one-on-one with George Stephanopoulos.
From ABC News, a special edition of This Week. President Joe Biden, his first television interview since the debate. The news-making exclusive, like now like reporting from Madison, Wisconsin, George Stephanopoulos.
Good evening from Madison, Wisconsin, for a special edition of This Week. The first broadcast interview with President Biden since...
By the way, I just want to point out something. This is how you know the Illuminati isn't real, okay?
Yeah, I was about to say that.
Like,
yeah.
The fact that they... Like, if the cloning shit was real, they would just replace Biden with a better clone.
Much better.
Like, what do you mean? They would give him all of the adrenochrome on the planet. So they could turn him into a dynamic person or literally swap him out with a new version. Obviously, this is like probably the greatest the greatest proof that this all this Illuminati shit ain't real, okay? I'm sorry. The Illuminati either A, fell off, or B, doesn't exist.
Since last week's debate, earlier this afternoon, we taped the 22-minute interview. There are no cuts, no edits. We have not touched it. At this pivotal moment in the presidential campaign, here it is.
Mr. President, thank you for doing this.
Thank you for having me.
Let's start with the debate. You and your team have said you had a...
One of the things that is really funny is that, like, I suspect this motherfucker is trying to be, like, he's trying to look like Trump. They tanned him.
Yeah.
That's they good, They tanned though. Him.
It works.
Trump would look like a monster if he didn't have that tan. Like, it actually makes him look better.
Yeah. They hit him with a orange glow. He's going, I said this already, but like he's going right wing on immigration. He literally is trying to build the wall. He went super orange and he has a fail son in the White House. Hunter Biden is now in the White House. It is literally Trump. It's Trump too, dude. He's trying to go for the Cheeto vote.
Bad night.
His fake tan's better though.
But your friend Nancy Pelosi actually framed the question that I think is on the minds of millions of Americans. Was this a bad episode? Or the sign of a more serious condition?
It's a bad episode. No indication of any serious condition. I was exhausted. I didn't listen to my instincts in terms of preparing.
Bro, I love that. Like the line is, I was flying around too much. Like he's flying Ryanair. Okay, like he's jumping. He's doing like connection flights and shit. You know what I mean? And he's sitting in a rickety old seat or something. Like, he's an Air Force One with a medical team, like, attached to his hip. That's number one. Number two, it was 11 days before the election. I didn't even know that. When I found out, because I thought personally, like, maybe he, like, flew a bunch of times before the election. I mean before the debate. But, like, when I found out that the last big travel that he did from Europe was 11 days before the... Before the debate, I lost my mind.
We've been here for 8 days and I'm still sleepy. So
you did, you did.
We
say
pulled
earlier
out that
today.
Defense this morning, so yeah. I understand.
It's crazy.
And a bad night.
Maybe he's having nightmares.
You know, you say you were exhausted, and I know you've said that before as well. But you came and you did have a tough month. But you came home from Europe about 11 or 12 days before the debate.
Like,
spent 6 days.
Every moment.
Yeah, because he has old man face. He can't fix that. Like that's the problem. They've done so many. Facelifts on his face, and it looks truly terrifying.
He's crying.
But the problem is, like, you can't fix that. This is just a byproduct of being that old. Like, gravity is working. Okay, you can't combat gravity. He always looks like this. He always is an old man face.
In Camp David, why wasn't that enough rest time, enough recovery time?
Because I was sick. I was feeling terrible. Matter of fact, the docs with me, I asked if they did a COVID test because they were trying to figure out what's wrong. They did a test to see whether or not I had some infection.
I'm the bravest boy. The doctors were like, you're the most sick man in America.
It's such a hard angle because you want to look like you're not old, so you're not sick. But in order to cover for not being able to talk,
he should have said he was hungover because he was partying so hard.
I was so hard. George, fucking... let me tell you, okay? The walls were sweating, okay? I was busting moves you haven't seen since the time when black people were not allowed to vote, okay? Like, I was busting moves left and right. You don't understand, George. I was going crazy with it.
you know, a virus. I didn't. I just had a really bad cold.
And did you ever watch the debate afterwards?
I don't think I did, no.
Oh, that's not good. What would...
Bro! What do you mean you didn't watch the debate? You didn't review the game footage?
But also, like, he could just say no. And yeah. That would have been better. He's like, I can't remember if the debate even happened.
Here's the good... Here's the one thing you should always not do when your cognitive abilities are being called into question. Say you can't remember something, okay? What? And it's not like... They're not asking you. They're not asking you about your like legislative agenda from 1984. Okay, they're asking you if you reviewed the debate that happened a week ago. At this point,
did you watch the VOD back, Biden?
It's bad.
What I want to get at is, what were you experiencing as you were going through the debate? Did you know how badly it was going?
Yeah. Look, the whole way I prepared, nobody's fault, mine. Nobody's fault but mine. I prepared what I usually would do, sitting down, as I did come back with foreign leaders or the National Security Council for explicit detail. And I realized about partway through that, I could quote it, the New York Times had me down at 10 points before the debate, 9 now or whatever the hell it is. The fact of the matter is that what I looked at is that he also lied 28 times. The way the debate ran, not my fault, no one else's fault.
But it seemed like you were having trouble from the first question in, even before he spoke.
Damn, George is not, okay, respect. Yeah. Dude, my respect for Greek people rose tremendously. George is not holding back, dude. It's like, bro, you sucked ass from the start.
When they asked you what your name was, you're
like, what's that about, dude? Why did your suck so bad?
But Trump lied 28 times though.
Yeah,
you gotta weigh those up.
Yeah, well, you know, the whole point is like he is supposed to ask for the. He's supposed to be able to counter that.
Yeah.
Well, I just had a bad night. You've had some bad interviews once in a while. I can't remember any, but I'm sure you did.
I've had plenty. I guess the question, the problem is here for a lot of Americans watching is you've said. Going back to 2020, watch me. Yep. To people who are concerned about your age,
like when you know 50 million grandparents and they're old and they're like they're having trouble talking. I never interrogate them and be like, "What's wrong with
let
you,
him
pa?"
Sleep.
Like it's like this is this happens to old people.
I think it's valid to do that though, because your grandparents are not running for president.
Well, they want to.
If your grandparents were like insisting on driving the car, you would be like, "Yeah, no, we're not going to do that." Like,
yeah.
No, that's crazy.
Let him sleep. Let him go to retirement home and. Yeah.
There is a like an air of sadness watching him perform. It is like a like elder abuse
it
a
is.
Little bit.
It's horrible. Let this
but
guy
also,
go.
You Stop. Cannot. You have to remember that, like, while it is sad and he's like white knuckling through this process, the entire reason why he's still staying in the race is like pure malicious narcissism. Yeah. Like the reason why he's staying in is because, like, in his mind, he thinks he's always been discounted. His entire political career, and now this is a moment of victory, and it's pure ego, pure spite.
You reckon it's personal? Surely the DNC was backing him, like, up until, right? Like, what's the...
Yeah, I mean, they saw him as, like a decent placeholder, because they were like, God forbid Bernie wins, you know what I mean? And then, like, we have a socialist republic of United, you know, we do a United States of Socialist America or something. United Socialist States of America, God forbid. So I think that, like, He was propped up as the guy to beat Trump, right? And now that, like, that's being called into question in the polling, that he is not beating Trump and others could potentially beat Trump, he is, he lost that. Like, he lost the one reason as to why people wanted him to be the guy.
He should lean into the dementia and just, like, nuke an ally. Just a random person. And then everyone's like, you know, it's like the madman thing. You know, you don't know what America's going to do. Everyone will suddenly get in
line. Entire madman theory is that you say you're going to nuke people, but you don't actually
do it.
He's
the first one to do it. It's like
he's going to do it and then forget he did it. He'd be I don't know if I did that.
I'm not sure.
Americans watched that debate. It seemed to confirm fears they already had.
Well, look, after that debate, I did 10 major events in a row, including until 2 o'clock in the morning after that debate. I did events in North Carolina. I did events in Georgia. Did events like this today. Large crowds, overwhelming response.
Very large crowd today.
No slipping.
Very.
And so I just had a bad night. I don't know why.
And how quickly did it come to you that you were having that bad night?
Well, Kane was having a bad night when I realized that even when I was answering a question, even though they turned his mic off, he was still shouting. And I let it distract me. I'm not blaming him on that. But I realized that I just...
But you are, though. But you are, though. Oh.
It's so insane.
Jeremy Corbyn, Francis' extraordinary electoral results provide an urgent, valuable lesson. Don't concede ground to it. Sow division and fear. Build a bold left movement that offers an alternative. My goat, my king, he's spoken. All right, let's continue.
Wasn't in control.
Sorry.
Well, part of the other concern is that this seems...
I see a Jeremy Corbyn tweet. I see a Corbyn tweet. I retweet. You know, it's that easy. It's that simple. The goat.
Into a pattern of decline that has been reported on recently. New York Times had a headline on July 2nd, Biden's lapses are said to be increasingly common and worrisome. Mm. Here's what they wrote. People who have spent time with President Biden over the last few months or so said the lapses appear to have grown more frequent, more pronounced, and after Thursday's debate, more worrisome. By many accounts, as evidenced by video footage, observation, and interviews, Mr. Biden is not the same today as he was even when he took office 3.5 years ago. Similar reporting in the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal. Are you the same man?
To be fair, I don't believe that. Like, I don't believe. Like, I believe that he's gotten worse since he got elected, for sure. But I don't believe that he was fine when he got elected either.
No.
Like, everyone with eyes to see could recognize that this dude, in comparison to his, like, 2012 performance in the vice presidential debate, in comparison to his 2016 performance, when he was, like, giving interviews, he was significantly worse. He was significantly worse than what he once was. And yet people just refuse to recognize it.
And today that you were when you took office 3.5 years ago.
In terms of successes, yes. I also was the guy who put together a peace plan for the Middle East that may become into fruition. I was also the guy that expanded NATO. I was also the guy that...
Dude, by the way, this is the funniest thing. Like, always, people are like, you're old. What's going on? Your brain's not working. He's like, well, I got NATO. It's like, yeah, dude, Americans are going to go crazy over NATO, dude. They're like, wow, Sweden and Finland join NATO? That's awesome. That makes me so happy that, like, the roads have holes the size of children in them. And also, we don't have healthcare. And the cost of living is, like, insane in this country. Oh, but Finland and Sweden join NATO. It's so sick. This is what is in the minds of the average Americans that are living in all of these states that are now contested. I said this a couple of years ago at this point where I was like, I really, really, really hope that the Democrats don't try to run on re-election on the account of like Ukraine, especially because like the pro-Ukrainian position will be significantly less popular by the time that he's running for re-election. It's not like the momentum that existed in the immediate aftermath of Vladimir Putin's unjustifiable invasion of Ukraine. Like, of course it was going to get, less popular in the eyes of Americans. And he's literally doing that. You should never bring that up. You should just only talk about abortion. You should only talk about how Trump is a genuine threat to democracy. But he's the worst person to talk about that anyway, because if Trump is a genuine threat to democracy, then you can't put a cadaver that is the least popular president, the least popular incumbent at this point, historically. You can't do that.
For the economy, all the individual things that were done were ideas I had or I fulfilled. I moved on. And so, for example, you know, well that was true then. What's Biden done lately? Today, just announced 200,000 new jobs. We're moving in a direction that no one's ever taken on. I know you know this from the days in the government. I took on Big Pharma. I beat them.
No one said I could beat them.
I took on all the things we said we got done. We're told we couldn't get done. And part of it is what I said when I ran was I wanted to do three things: restore some decency to the office, restore some support for the middle class instead of trickle down economics, built from the middle out and the bottom up. That way, the wealthy still do fine. Everyone does better. and unite the country.
But what has all that work over the last 3.5 years cost you physically, mentally, emotionally?
He really just has one question the whole time. He's like, but
I just think it cost me a really bad night, bad run. But, you know.
Bad run.
George.
He's starting to fuck up.
I'm optimistic about this country. I don't think we're a country.
Wait, what? Where? What does that have to do with anything?
Yeah, where'd that come
from? Bro, went from 6 minutes in, he's already flubbing. He's like, I don't know. I'm optimistic about the country. God damn.
Losers that he puts out. I don't think America's in tough shape. I think America's on the cusp of breaking through on so many incredible opportunities. This next term, I'm going to make sure we have a straighten out the tax system.
Next week.
I'm going to make sure we're in a situation where we have health care for all people.
He's about to be like, we beat Medicare, George. When I say we beat Medicare, I mean it. We beat it. No
we're
more
in
Medicare.
A position where we have child care and elder care, free
face?
Up, and all these things. The one thing I'm proudest of is remember when my economic plan was put forward, a lot of the mainstream economists said it's not going to work. Well, guess what? You now have 16 Nobel laureates, 16 of them in economics, saying that Biden's next term would be, based on what he wants to do, enormous success. Trump's plan would cause a recession, would significantly increase inflation. I've made great progress, and that's what I plan on doing, and we can do this.
I understand that, and I'm not disputing that, but I'm asking you about your personal situation. Do you dispute that there have been more lapses, especially in the last several months?
It looks like he's trying to get a sentence out without shitting himself.
Can I run 110 flat? No.
Wait, hold on. We're going to run that question back. What were you saying? You said he's really tensed up, like he's shitting?
Yeah, like he has to like talk, but also simultaneously like try not to shit himself.
Chad, it couldn't be an Alexa appearance without a shit joke. Yeah. You know.
I just know the face. I'm the face.
You know this man can't stop himself. You know this man can't stop himself from bringing poo into the equation. Okay.
Alexa is pretty right though. This is out of the blue.
Yeah, he is right. This is why I brought you in. You're the poo. You're the poo specialist.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's a poo face.
Can I run the 110 flat? No. But I'm still in good shape.
Are you more frail?
No.
No.
You're frail, Mr. President.
I know you
come
spoke.
Keep my schedule.
I know you spoke with your doctor after the debate. What did he say?
He said he just looked at me. He said you're exhausted. I said, look, I have medical doctors traveling me everywhere. Every president does, as you know. Medical doctors, some of the best in the world, travel me everywhere I go.
Travel me.
I have an ongoing assessment of what I'm doing. They don't hesitate to tell me if they think there's something wrong.
I know you said you have an ongoing assessment. Have you had a full nerve?
I like that he said, my doctor just looked at me.
Yeah.
My doctor looked at me and said, bro, he's like, we're not going to make it across the finish line, Joe.
I didn't notice before, but you're 88. That's what I'm noticing.
Yeah, you're not a good 88, okay? You're the bad one. Doctors are lying because they get paid well. I don't even think the doctors are lying. The doctors are probably telling him, like, your shit's up, dude. He's not going to say it.
No.
Wait, what? Biden is making a move against Kamala? Second gentleman, MHOS, test positive. Oh, Biden hit with a COVID gun. He's trying to kill Kamala. Protect Mamala. Protect Mamala at all costs. He hit him with a COVID ray, dude.
What the hell is second gentleman Emhoff? Am I missing
that's
this
Kamala Harris's husband, second gentleman.
Yeah. What it's called.
Yeah, the first wife or the first gentleman would be the partner of the president. And the second wife or the second gentleman in this case would be the partner of the vice president. K-Hive, activate. We must protect Mamala. Okay, all right, let's continue.
Neurological and cognitive evaluation.
I get a full neurological test.
First wife, first lady, sorry.
First wife.
Shut up, chat. I just traveled from Koshia. You don't understand. It's actually 1 p.m. for me. Right now, Jack. I'm tired and I'm running for president. I'm having a bad debate night.
Every day with me.
You're a bit too loud.
I'm having a bad debate night. I'm experiencing cognitive decline, malarkey. This is the question that got clipped? What do you mean? big clip this?
Test every day.
Evaluation.
I get a full neurological test every day with me. And I've had a full physical. I had, you know, I mean, I've been at Walter Reed for my physicals. I mean, yes.
I know your doctor said he consulted with a neurologist. I guess I'm asking a slightly different question. Have you had the specific cognitive tests? And have you had a neurologist, a specialist, do an examination?
You want to lie.
No one said I had to. No one said they said I'm good.
Would you be willing to undergo an independent medical evaluation that included neurological and cognitive tests and release the results to the American people?
Just look, I have a cognitive test every single day. Every day I have
that test. Okay, I'm not kidding. If I remember correctly, if my political autism is working right now, I'm almost certain Trump said this exact same thing.
Said he was the best.
I've never seen someone ace it.
No, I'm pretty sure Trump directly responded to the question of him experiencing cognitive decline with, my job as the president is a test every day.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I'm not even kidding.
Wait, the thing he said directly before this was, why would I have to do one? And then he's like, oh, actually, I do it all the time. I'm doing one right now.
Wait, oh, really? Did I call it? I stubbed my toe. That's immigrants. Undocumented migrants. They're changing the furniture in your homes. And you're stubbing your toes.
That is horrible.
Medicare.
The question was about what would you do to make childcare more affordable?
Huh? that's a banger, dude. I mean, that is literally what happened in the debate.
Anything I do, you know, not only am I campaigning, but I'm running the world. It sounds like hyperbole, but we are the essential nation of the world. I don't know if it was right. And every single day, for example, today, before I come out here, I'm on the phone with the Prime Minister of, well, anyway, I shouldn't get into detail, but.
Oh, good side.
With Netanyahu. On the phone with the new Prime Minister of England. I'm working on what we're doing with regard to in Europe, with regard to expansion of NATO and whether it's going to stick. I'm taking on Putin. I mean, every day, there's no day I go through. They're not those decisions I have to make every single day.
And you have been doing that, and the American people have been watching, yet their concerns about your age and your health are growing. So that's why I'm asking, to reassure them, would you be willing to have the independent medical evaluation?
Watch me between. There's a lot of time left in this campaign.
He always loves saying, watch me. And it's like weird because we did. That's why you're doing this interview. Yeah, because we watched you and nobody liked what they saw. Okay? So he just keeps going, no, watch me more. Watch me more. I will surely not flub this time. You want to order food? So why are you coming over? What'd you order?
Mendocino.
Okay, it's fine. I'm tracking his macros.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, you didn't wait for me to order
your
food.
Did you log it into your app?
No.
You need to log it. You need to get a MyFitnessPal. He's trying to lose weight.
I want to be...
But the question I asked was to Murat. He walked over. Watch me. Between the hours of 10 a.m. and 4 p.m.
It's over 125 days.
So the answer...
Make a decision.
The right answer right now is no. You don't want to do that right now.
No, I've already done it.
You talked a lot about your successes at the beginning of this interview, and I don't want to dispute that. I don't want to debate that. But as you know, elections are about the future, not the past. They're about tomorrow, not yesterday. And the question on so many people's minds right now is, can you serve effectively for the next 4 years?
George, I'm the guy that put NATO together, the future. No one thought I could expand it. I'm the guy that shut Putin down. No one thought...
Bro, no, dude, I'm sorry. Like, I know I'm the worst person, especially sitting next to the only other people that are the worst people to talk about this, but is this legitimately a thing that people will be like, yeah, he put NATO together? Like,
is he talking about like back in like 1945? Or like,
yeah. He's like, we took those Nazi generals and we put them in the power, Jack. We brought West Germany into NATO. And we got those, they were saying the Reich generals, we got them in there. No, like, it's like, oh yeah, I expanded NATO. First of all, that was Putin. Okay. So put some respect on it. He literally gave you that gift. And secondly, I don't understand, like, why, like, is this actually a solid approach? Like, I don't, brother, liberals love NATO. No, dude, you are thinking of liberals on Reddit and liberals on Twitter, okay? People with globe emojis do not represent the broader electorate. They never have and they never will. They do not represent the broader electorate, just like Hammer and Sickle Twitter does not represent the broader electorate, okay? It doesn't work that way. Like, we're talking about, in its heyday, Twitter was like, what, 20% of the American population was on Twitter, okay? In its heyday. That number is probably much, much lower now. Like, there is no... The only way that Twitter actually changes discourse in the real world is because all the journalists used to be on Twitter, so they would write about shit on Twitter endlessly, okay? The Democratic Party's interest in, like, NATO and American foreign policy and, like, you know, continuing American dominance or whatever is not necessarily something that the rest of the Americans give a fuck about. I just don't think that... I don't think that, like, this is as good as a take. I don't think this is as good as a take as, like, you know, Brandon thinks it is. Like, he should focus on... He should focus on domestic policies. He should focus on how the NLRB is, you know, going after bad businesses that are legitimately, you know, f***ing over workers. He should talk about the IRA. He should talk about, like, all of the infrastructure investments that his administration was able to accomplish, regardless of the Republicans and their obstructionist capacity. I don't think that, like, you know, I expanded NATO is gonna be a successful re-election message. It doesn't show up at all in the polls, by the way. Like, even Gaza is like number four, right? A lot of people don't care about foreign policy. When they do, it's like significant for them. But ultimately, NATO is nowhere near in those polls. Like, when they look at it, it's like number one is democracy is like the number one concern. Cost of living is the number one concern. Democracy is like a close second sometimes. But like nowhere in those polls they talk about, like, oh yeah, we expanded NATO. It's awesome. Like, I don't think people care.
What could happen? I'm the guy that put together the South Pacific Initiative with AUKUS. I'm the guy that got 50 nations.
Out, that's why
not
I love
only
him.
In Europe, outside of Europe.
He's
as well.
He's so old, it's going out of focus.
Ukraine.
You can't even tell there's a person.
I'm the guy that got Japanese to expand their budget.
These are ultimately very bad things that he did. Yeah. Like, he's talking about how he expanded the Japanese defense industry. Okay. Like, not only is it irrelevant to the average American voter, but it's also not a good thing for the world.
No, I think it's pretty exciting for Americans. You get to nuke them again. That's so cool.
Yeah. It's like, I'm the one who's beefing up the Japanese war machine. I'm the one who's beefing up the German war machine. I'm the one who's beefing up the Italian war machine. Let me tell you, Jack, we're running it back, okay? World War III. This time we're on the right side. This is all about going into a Cold War with China so that we can sanction them and constrain their economy so that we remain the biggest economy. I know, but like, I don't think that that is like an attitude. I don't think that's Americans are thinking about that. He would have a much easier time being like, I defeated China.
Yeah.
Okay. He should just say that. You know what I mean? He should just be like, China is rising and we're going to kill them. We're going to kill all the Chinese. That would probably be a more populist framing.
That's kind of what he's saying. It's just like,
No. Democrats love doing this insane technocratic approach and like incredibly convoluted messaging that appeals to like Paul Krugman and Paul Krugman only. Okay. Like, this is not a winning narrative for the average Americans. The average American, they're xenophobic too. Like, they're afraid of China for sure. They don't know exactly why, but they're afraid of China. They're told that China is bad. And that's one thing. So just say it like that. I'm defeating China by creating strong allegiances. But even then that's not a winning narrative in general. You know what I mean?
And for example, when I decided we used to have 40% of the computer chip, and we invented the chip, the little chip, the computer chip. It's in everything from cell phone to web.
We're going to run that back.
For example,
I love it.
When I decided we used to have 40% of the computer chip, and we invented the chip, the little chip, the computer chip. It's in everything from cell phone to weapons. And so we used to have 40%, we're down to virtually nothing. So I get in the plane against the advice of everybody, and I fly to South Korea. I convince them to invest in the United States, billions of dollars. Now we have tens of billions of dollars being invested in the United States, making us back in a position where we're going to own that industry.
Making us back.
We have, I mean, I just...
Like, this is also, this is like exactly the type of shit that Trump would say. The problem is Trump would say it in a better way.
With enough conviction that you're like, yeah.
Like, this is unironically like Trump right now. Oh, the chips, you know, those chips, they're in computers, the little chips. They're so tiny. They're the best chips. We used to make the best chips. We don't make the best chips anymore. China's making all the chips. I brought it back. I brought the chips back. The Koreans. I brought the Korean chips to America. Like, he's like trying to, you know, trying to be more. He's trying to do the, you know, he's now trying to do the narrative that like is more understandable to the average American, but still failing to do so because he's too f-ing old.
Anyway, I don't want to take too much credit. I have a great staff.
But all the, I guess my point is all that takes a toll. Do you have the mental and physical capacity to do it for another 4 years?
I believe so. I wouldn't be running if I didn't think I did.
No, Otmar. Look,
I'm running again because I think I understand best what has to be done to take this nation to a completely new level. We're on our way. We're on our way. And look, the decision recently made by the Supreme Court on immunity. You know, the next president of the United States, it's not just about whether he or she knows what they're doing. It's not about a conglomerate of people making decisions. It's about the character of the president. The character of the president.
Yeah, it's some intractable third thing. It's just the vibes. It's the aura. It's the aura of the presidency. Okay. No, it absolutely is about like administrative competency, man. Like, what are we talking about?
I love it where he does this thing where he leans in and makes his voice deeper.
Yeah.
President's going to determine whether or not this Constitution is employed the right way.
Let me ask you a tougher, more personal question. Are you sure you're being honest with yourself? And you say you have the mental and physical capacity.
George, bringing it back. Let's go. It's like
half an hour.
George's like, okay, Grandpa, tell me about your brain again. Yeah. Let's run that until you're exhausted and you do flub. At least his face is not doing the weird thing anymore. In the beginning, he's always like, and then I think he like starts.
Yeah, no, I think he moves his face around until he finds a default position where he's like, okay, better, I'll sit here.
I will say this is a better default position for his face.
Like
than
he still looks like he can't hear you. It's so like he's like tilting through one way.
Remember when there was a clip of him doing that and saying we need to cut Social Security and Medicare, and when Bernie played the clip, the entire corporate media just reported that Biden was being sarcastic? I do remember. Yeah. He to be fair to him though, he wasn't lying. He just didn't remember what he said about Social Security.
To serve another 4 years.
Yes, I am, because George, last thing I want to do is not be able to meet that. I think as some of senior economist and senior foreign policy specialist say, if I stop now, I go down history as a pretty successful president. No one thought I could get done what we got done.
But are you being honest with yourself as well
now he's
about your ability
Biden.
To defeat Donald Trump right now?
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
You say that, and let me challenge you.
He's such a narcissist. I'm gonna go back to this, okay? This is all ego, bro. This is a full ego run right now. Like, the entire narrative is he's still running on like I'm the best. I'm the only guy to beat Trump. When like, obviously, people from inside of the administration are saying, no, that's not the case. Here's a scoop from Alex Thompson at Axios. A look at the template that the White House sent staffers organizing events for POTUS. I staffed a simple fundraiser to a private residence, but they treated it like it was a NATO summit with his movements, a person who staffed a Biden event said. They're literally directing him specifically on like which directions he needs to go to. The private fundraiser that he did, by the way, he actually used a teleprompter on. I think the last private fundraiser that he did, he didn't even go off the cuff. He used the teleprompter. Which also got donors worried because they were like, what the f-? He can't even talk to us? That is actually legitimately scary. Okay?
You should have given him more money.
Since the debate, the some Dems who attended and helped set up Biden events have wondered whether his team's focus on minute details were to obscure POTUS's limitations rather than just a reflection of a meticulous staff. Yeah, Disney Air is pulled out already. What is this? Reality check. Organizing presidential events, often called advanced work, is very intensive and detail-focused for every commander-in-chief. Yeah, there's a difference, though. And normally, they don't use teleprompters at donor events. And they definitely shouldn't use a teleprompter at a donor event, a closed-door private donor meeting, especially when people are saying, you can't talk without a teleprompter. When that's like the major concern that donors have with you, okay? When that's the major concern that donors have with you, then, you know, you need to address that concern head on by literally not using a teleprompter and going off the cuff. It's a private event.
I kind of respect that, though. Like, whenever we do sponsorships, I'm like, I wish I was using a teleprompter this.
Well, that's why at the top of the hour, that's why I have a script right there on the side where I tell you that there's a 3-minute ad break at the top of the hour. And if you no longer want to see those ads, all you need to do is subscribe for $5 or for free with a Twitch Prime by connecting your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account where you get one free Prime subscription a month.
A month.
Do you want to get
joining me now?
Use it on your favorite broadcaster. Hopefully it's me. I love the ad reads the boys do. You can tell they really love the product. Yeah, no, I can.
Thank you.
What was your last one? It was a business.
Shut up.
No, they're great. I could tell. Like, I'm using it now.
Yeah, same.
Yeah, no, I downloaded
really
it.
Really good for my workflow.
Yeah, I downloaded
it. Communicating with all my employees.
I downloaded it after to manage my employees.
Kanban's great.
Oh, yeah. Gantt?
Yeah.
What a way to fucking look at stuff.
Yeah. Okay, here's the 3-minute ad break now, Jack.
Yeah. Senior economist and senior foreign policy specialist say, if I stop now, I go down history as a pretty successful president. No one thought I could get done what we...
Yeah, that's like, bro, that's they're saying that so you drop out. They're like, yeah, everyone is saying that so you drop out. They're like, yeah, dude, come on, you have a great legacy already. Please up, leave.
I already ordered something.
What did you order? What are you ordering? Okay.
That sounds fine.
I'll have it.
Oh, by the way. Damn, this man is a monster, bro. He is not stopping. He's eating, dude. You got to put on some weight.
Yeah, I'm trying.
My weed shop has a Kanban board for their deliveries. Nice. I don't know if Kanban is Australian.
No, Kanban is is like a organizational tool for...
I have no idea.
We learn it for our sponsors.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which we use.
Why did you say you have no idea then?
No, I love it.
That's weird. You just said you don't know what it is. Okay. Can you hand me my phone? Thank you, sir.
My guy's here.
What did Finn? You didn't get some food.
I was gonna ask, but he was on a roll about some unimportant political stuff.
Yeah. Boo, boring politics, dude.
I was
four more senior Dems call on Biden to stand down from re-election bid. Other Democrats also expressed concerns. This happened today. Hakeem Jeffries had a all hands meeting with the entirety of the Democratic Party, the House of Representatives, the Democrats in the House of Representatives. And now four more senior Dems are calling for Biden to stand down, including, but not limited to, Representative Jerry Nadler, who is also famous for pooping in his pants. Okay. Like, I'm not kidding. Really? He's also 800.
I've got a $100 bet on Kamala being president.
That's crazy. You got a $100 bet on Kamala winning the election or becoming the...
No, winning.
The f*** did you get?
Oh, that. Yeah.
That is not healthy, bro. I would not have allowed you to eat that if it were up to me. This man is so old, he tucks his into his waistband. Oh, my God. What an image. You're not wrong, but sometimes you should keep that in. You know what I mean? You shouldn't say that.
We got time.
But are you being honest with yourself as well about your ability to defeat Donald Trump right now?
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
You say that, and let me challenge you. Sure. Because you were close, but behind going into the debate. You're further behind now by any measure. It's been a two-man race for several months. Inflation has come down. In those last few months, he's become a convicted felon, yet you're still falling further behind.
You guys keep saying that. George, you know polling better than anybody. Do you think polling data is accurate as it used to be?
I don't think so, but I think when you look at all of the polling data right now, it shows that he's certainly ahead in the popular vote, probably even more ahead in the battleground states. And one of the other key factors there is it shows that in many of the battleground states, the Democrats who are running for Senate in the House are doing better than you are.
Well, that's not unusual in some states. I carried an awful lot of Democrats last time I ran in 2020. Look, I remember them telling me the same thing in 2020. I can't win. The polls show I can't win. Remember 2020, the red wave was coming. Before the vote, I said, that's not going to happen. We're going to win. We did better in an off year than almost any incumbent president ever has done. They said in 2023, all the tough races, we're not going to win. I went into all those areas, all those districts, and we won.
All that is true, but 2020 was a close race. And your approval rating has dropped significantly since then. I think the last poll I saw was at about 36%.
Sounds delicious.
The number of Americans who think you're too old to serve has doubled since 2020. Wouldn't a clear-eyed political calculus tell you that it's going to be much tougher to win in 2024?
Not when you're running against a pathological liar.
I love the lying. It's so
yeah.
Stupid.
That's the guy I told Brandon.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. People say he has a disability. That's why he walks like that. But I think
himself is a disability.
Yeah, I think it's because he poops his pants. I refuse to believe people that say that. Okay. Anyway, he's the guy who told Brandon to step down because he's too old. That's pretty crazy. I know what that looks like when you fart, and then it turns out there's more to that fart than you previously assumed. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
And we've all been there.
If he was walking like that, that was a big mess. Yeah. Like,
that's when it gets down to your ankles and you have to like kind of slide.
Yeah.
Them so you're not,
yeah.
We know what that's like. Don't lie to me like that. Oh yeah. He's a disability.
Not when he hadn't been challenged in a way that he's about to be challenged. Not when people.
You've had months to challenge him.
Oh, I sure had months, but I was also doing a hell of a lot of other things like wars around the world. Like keeping
neighborhood. Yeah, I was doing too many wars. That's good, man. It's a good take. You're killing this interview, dude. Congratulations. I was doing NATO.
Yeah, pretty stressful.
Like working anyway. But look.
And he hit the anyway. That's my favorite. When he just cuts himself off and he's like, anyway.
That's smart. Smarter than continuing.
Yeah. No, but he already goes too far. He already says it when he's been silent for 10 seconds.
Yeah, and then he just shuts up. He's like, we shouldn't explore that avenue any further.
Do you really believe you're not behind right now?
I think all the pollsters I talk to tell me it's a toss-up. It's a toss-up.
Because your closest allies and your staffers, I think, are lying to you.
Yeah.
Like, and also, it's not even true. You know there's bad polls. An internal poll leaked from the Biden camp, like one of the numbers they were looking at that they did not want out there that was leaked to Axios that showed post-debate performance, like he dropped significant points in key states. Also, even when his own internal pollsters are telling him or his staffers are telling him, oh, it's a toss-off, Mr. President, that's not good. That's bad. That means you're not winning. It shouldn't be a toss-up. You're the incumbent. As an incumbent, you have the advantage. You're supposed to have the incumbent's advantage. Okay?
Do they historically win?
What?
Do they historically win?
Yeah, usually. Unless they like f***ed up big time, like Trump with COVID. Unless there's like a once-in-a-lifetime, you know, global event like COVID. Yeah, usually the incumbent has the advantage.
When I'm behind, there's only one.
And right now, that's the other thing. Right now, he is the incumbent. Yeah, here's the leaked poll. Leaked Dem internal polling from Open Labs, progressive nonprofit that conducts polling and message testing for a constellation of Democratic groups, including the preferred super PAC for Biden's reelection campaign. Their website is mostly blank. They don't seek publicity. Their client list is closely held, but their data-driven memos are trusted in Democratic circles and typically passed around a small group of clients and strategists. But it's just not looking too good. Look at this. Post-debate margin.
Came Alexa.
Like, he's dropping off the map. What's up? Oh, what the
He's just watching me eat.
Ew. Listen, he might not win in 2024, but Biden, I think, has a real chance in 2028. Yeah, oh, 100%.
Poll, I'm really far behind. CBS poll. And NBC,
New York Times and NBC both have you about 6 points behind in the popular vote.
That's exactly right. New York Times had me behind before anything happened to do with this race. Had me behind 10 points. points. 10 points had to be high. Nothing's changed substantially in the debate in the New York Times poll.
Just when you look at the reality, though, Mr. President, I mean, you won the popular vote in 2020, but it was still deadly close in the electoral
by
college.
7 million votes.
Yes, but you're behind now in the popular vote.
I don't buy that.
Huh? Is it worth the risk?
I don't think anybody's more qualified to be president or win this race than me.
You know, the heart of your case against Donald Trump is that he's only out for himself, putting his personal interest ahead of the national interest. How do you respond to critics who say that by staying in the race, you're doing the same thing?
Oh, come on. Come on. Well, I don't think those critics know what they're talking about.
They're just wrong.
Wait, is that the face? Did I miss it?
Did the really good face.
You know, the heart of your case against Donald Trump is that he's only out for himself, putting his personal interest ahead of the national interest. How do you respond to critics who say that by staying in the race, you're doing the same thing?
Oh, come on. Well, I don't think those critics know what they're talking about.
That is actually a really solid question because it is exactly what he's doing.
Yeah.
The only reason for him to stay in this race at this moment is his own personal ego. He is vindictive. He is spiteful. And that is the only reason why he's staying in the motherfucking race.
I think his motives are too complex for the journalist, to be fair.
Yeah, just like Macron.
Yeah.
Dude, but like, it's just so stupid. It's just like, how can anyone look at this interview and go, wow, he really made a solid case here. I definitely feel like he's the only guy to win when polls are showing the exact opposite. And that was the only reason why he was propped up as the candidate in 2020.
It's so confronting seeing it now, like the first time the media is like doing their job with him.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, this should have been fucking like 5 years
ago. Yeah, that's why it's so annoying. You're like, what is like, wrong with
he
you?
He would have this like this
before. Like,
yeah, no, if they did this to him in 2020,
Bernie. Finally ask the 90-year-old if he's too old.
They're just wrong.
It's wrong. Look, Trump is a pathological liar. Trump is, he is. Have you ever seen anything Trump did that benefited somebody else, not him? You can't answer, I know.
I've questioned him and his allies as persistently as any journalist has.
No, I know you have. I'm not being critical.
Yeah.
I'm not being critical. But look, I mean,
what?
The man is a congenital liar. As I said, they pointed out in that debate, he lied 27, 28 times the times, or whatever number, over 20 times. Talk about how good his economy was, how he brought down inflation, how this is a guy who, unlike only other president other than him, is Hoover, lost more jobs than he created. This is a guy who told us to put bleach in our arms to deal with COVID, when over a million people died. This is a guy who talks about wanting to get rid of the health care provision we put in place. This is a guy who wants to give the power back to big pharma to be able to charge exorbitant prices for drugs. This is the guy who wants to undo every single thing I've done. Every single thing.
I understand that. I understand that's why you want to stay in the race. But have you convinced yourself that only you can defeat him?
I convinced myself of two things. I'm the most qualified person to beat him, and I know how to get things done.
If you can be convinced that you cannot defeat Donald Trump, will you stand down?
Yeah.
Well, it depends if, and if the Lord Almighty comes out and tells me that, I might do that.
Well,
what are you? Oh my God!
No, that was smart. Everyone I speak to here is Christian.
Yeah, no,
that's just
not
an American thing.
Yeah, if Jesus Christ comes down and is like, "Bro, you got to drop out," then I'll drop out. Is really good. That's sick.
I mean, I don't think they really have an option though.
If an 81-year-old doctor who struggled to complete sentences looked down at me in the operating table and said he didn't care if I lived or not as long as he tried his hardest and did his best, I'm not sure that would be comforting. Hey doc, there are other people invested in the outcome of this procedure than just you. Yeah, I mean, he's right. That's a good take from Ryan.
I'm not that invested.
Yeah, but you're in Australia, dude. Okay.
I'm happy.
Yeah, we already got AUKUS, which is what he was really stoked on. He's like, we already got the nuclear submarine.
That's fine.
I'm good. I got my bag. Yeah, over my dead body is basically what he's saying here, which is crazy.
I mean, on a more practical level, Washington Post just reported in the last hour that Senator Mark Warner is assembling a group of senators together to try and convince you to stand down because they don't think you can win.
Well, Mark is a good man. We've never had that. He also tried to get the nomination too. Mark's not.
He didn't. What does he mean? Am I wrong on this? I don't think Mark. Wait, what? Did Mark Warner run for president? Why did he say he tried to get the nomination?
That was so loud.
Mark Warner tried to get the nomination in 2008. He formed an exploratory committee in 2008, but decided not to run. I don't think he's talking about that. Why would you bring that up?
Maybe he just leaked something he wasn't meant to leak.
No, this literally feels like he tried to be like, yeah, Mark is just jealous of my steez. but like, that's such a weird thing to say. What that, like, bro, the libs think Biden didn't have a brain fart here. The fact that Biden can recall on the spot that Warner planned the run in 2008 while you failed to do even basic research before posting this asinine ramble. Oh my God.
It was a mistake. It was
ramble. Asinine ramble. Dude, the way that these guys write, like, oh my God, dude. Re-education camps for them too. Okay. No. Also, even if he did lock down a 2008, like, failed attempt to run with an exploratory committee in 2006 or whatever, even if that was what he was recalling, that still proves the point that I was making, which is that when you are demented, when you are experiencing dementia, early stages, middle stages, late stages of dementia, you have perfect recall of events that transpired many, many years ago, but you can't remember what you ate for breakfast. Yeah. Okay? That's the problem. It's not 2010. It's 2024.
Also, there's no way he remembered that. That was just a mistake and he got lucky. He slipped.
I think he just up. Yeah. I don't think he's like doing perfect recall.
Mark and I have a different perspective. I respect him.
And if Chuck Schumer and Hakeem Jeffries and Nancy Pelosi come down and say, we're worried that if you stay in the race, we're going to lose the House and the Senate, how will you respond?
I go into detail with them. I've spoken to all of them in detail, including Jim Clyburn. Every one of them. They all said I should stay in the race. Stay in the race. No one said, none of the people said I should leave.
But if they do?
Well, it's like, they're not going to do that.
You sure?
Well, yeah, I'm sure. Look, I mean, if the Lord Almighty came down and said, Joe, get out of the race, I'd get out of the race. The Lord Almighty's not coming down. I mean, these hypothetical.
Damn, bro. He's just like, no, the only way I drop out is if God tells me to is a crazy thing.
You look at all that drool.
Yeah, but also you covered Kyra in food.
Yeah,
she likes that.
She was picking it off herself. It was so cute. That's why she knows to sit under you when you eat.
Yeah.
Look at all these freebies.
Uncle George.
It's not that hypothetical anymore. I grant that they have not requested the meeting. But it's been reported.
I met with them. I've met with a lot of these people. I've talked with them regularly.
Did Moran get you a bowl? I had an hour
conversation with Hakeem. I had more time with them than Jim Clyburn. I spent time with many hours off and on the last little bit with Chuck Schumer. It's not like I had all the governors. All the governors.
I agree that the Lord Almighty is not going to come down, but if you...
Yes, God is personally not going to smite you, sir. Is there any other reason for you to drop out?
Are told reliably from your allies, from your friends and supporters in the Democratic Party, in the House and the Senate, that they're concerned you're going to lose the House and the Senate if you stay in. What will you do?
I'm not going to answer that question. It's not going to happen.
That's a good answer.
What's your plan to turn the campaign around?
You saw it today.
This, which is great.
Yeah, he's doing well.
He's killing it. This definitely did a number, dude. Even the most like diehard loyalists are having a hard time coping with this. From what I understand, some people on Twitter were talking about, because like that's where the most like aggro DNC defenders are, or in the Democratic Party defenders are. And even they were like, oh, they actually cooked Biden. They f***ed up the audio deliberately.
I heard that.
This feels more like an intervention than an interview. It feels like George is a grown son trying to convince his dad it's no longer okay to drive the Ford into town. Yeah, I've never seen a president with 36% approval getting reelected. It's true. It's bad. It's really bad.
How many people can you get draw crowds like I drew today?
Again, another Trumpism. Yeah. Dude, He studied his opponent, okay? Let me tell you. He studied his opponent well. He is adopting all of the Trump tropes. It's awesome. Ah, I got big rallies. I got big crowds, Jack.
Find any more enthusiastic than today?
Huh?
I don't think you want to play the crowd game. Donald Trump can draw big crowds. There's no question about that.
He can draw a big crowd, but what does he say? Who does he have? I'm the guy supposedly in trouble. We raised 38.
Wait, what? No, you literally said you can draw a big crowd. and now he's like, well, you draw a big crowd, but like it doesn't look too good in comparison to Trump's big crowds. What the fucking app still doesn't work? I'm so annoyed.
Is he outside?
Over a million individual contributors.
I am, but I don't
individual
know.
Individual contributors. Less than $200. I've not seen what you're proposing.
Oh, Connor is here.
You haven't seen the fall off in the polls. You haven't seen the reports of discontent in the Democratic Party, House Democrats.
If you want some definitive proof that ABC destroyed the audio in Biden's interview, here you are. Left original audio, right denoised audio. Biden's mic was EQ'd to pick up as much low and high-end ambient noise as possible, which is why his voice sounds so much more distorted than Stephanopoulos. Even with noise removal, the audio was beyond salvaging. You can listen for yourself. Biden's team, if you're listening, never do another network interview speech unless your own audio engineers get to set up the equipment. Connor, we're still doing this, so I'll bring you in a little bit. What's good, King? How you doing? You look good. Look at those big ass pants you're wearing. Cool. Fucking fashion icon, you. God damn, dude. He's sexy as fuck. He's still wearing the off-white jacket, though. He hasn't taken that shit off in years, okay? You can pry that jacket off of his dead body, cold dead body.
Senate Democrats.
I've seen it from the press.
You know, I've heard from dozens of your supporters over the last few days, and a variety of views. I grant you that. But also,
George Stephanopoulos' audio is picking up ambient noise, too. Like, I think this is just a case of like the audio engineer is being incompetent. It's not like Stephanopoulos' voice is clear. It's people are so
the prevailing sentiment is this.
Where do they get access to the non-gated one?
And they will be forever grateful to you,
by the way,
for defeating Donald Trump in 2020. They think you've done a great job as president. A lot of the successes you outlined. But they are worried about you and the country, and they don't think you can win. They want you to go with grace, and they will cheer you if you do. What do you say to them?
I say the vast majority are not where those folks are. I don't doubt there's some folks there. Have you ever seen a group at time when elected officials running for office aren't a little worried? Have you ever seen that?
Bro, that's a little different than... Yeah. Polling at 36%. What are we, dude? 36% approval rating is so bad. You're underwater. Like what? This is a little bit different than this, and it's getting lower too. This is a little bit different than like being worried about your reelection chances. You know what I mean? Legitimately, it is legitimately worse than any other historic low at this point.
I'm not. Same thing happened in 2020. Oh, Biden, I don't know, man. What's he going to do?
Someone older than him is giving you advice.
Nothing changed except his voice just went deeper.
That's a good one. I like that. He should do that voice more often. Yeah,
same thing happened in 2020. Oh, Biden, I don't know, man. What's he going to do? He may bring me down. He may.
What?
Mr. President, I've never...
What? Oh no!
His old man is exactly the same as normal Biden.
Yeah. An even older man than Biden has come out and told him with his gravelly voice that, I don't know, he might be a little too old.
I completely understand why Biden hasn't watched the debate. I would not watch any of this. Have you watched a video of someone like filming you drunk? You like very actively try to avoid saying that.
Yeah.
We're seeing a president at 36% approval get reelected.
Well, I don't believe that's my approval rate. That's not what our polls show.
What? What? He's just like, he's just on pure cope. He's like, nah, those polls are fake and wrong and gay. I don't care. I don't care. Jack, polls are lying. I'm so goddamn popular.
And if you stay in and Trump is elected and everything you're warning about comes to pass, how will you feel in January?
I feel as long as I gave it my all and I did the goodest job as I know I can do. That's what this is about.
No. No. That's not what this is about. You're insane. You are insane. What an unimaginably selfish response. He's like, if you lose because everyone told you you're too old and you're going to lose to Trump... and he refused to drop out, how would you feel? Well, I still try my best. It's like, no, dude, you can't say that.
Yeah.
Who, like, dude, people watching this is not just Jill Biden and your mom, okay? Like, this is like the entire American public, or at least much less than the people that watch the debate, but like still a pretty decent number of people are watching this conversation. Like, they don't think, oh, I love Joe Biden so much. Like, it's fine. As long as he tried his best.
Yeah.
Like, that's insane. Who do you think you are? That's crazy. As long as I tried my best. Where is the narcissism in this circumstance? You should be like, yo, that's not going to happen because I'm going to win.
I'm pretty unfamiliar with, like, American English. Is goodest a normal word for you guys? Or is it?
No, goodest is not a... No, he... that up too, but that's fine. That's like whatever.
It's a small slip.
But this is insane to think that, like, oh, I tried my very best and that's what matters. Like, no, dude, this isn't like Little League, okay? We're not going off for lemonade after baseball. Okay? You're out of your mind, dog. Fuck you mean. Oh, I tried my best and then it that's all that matters. No. That's not all that matters. There's things that matter so much more than that. Actually, that's the least significant part of this conversation.
Everyone at the end is just like, good try.
Yeah.
You did well.
Better luck next time.
Yeah, what are we talking about? I thought this was about saving democracy, not saving Biden's opinions, dude. Is not saving Biden's, like, the personal confidence. He's going to lose and deny the results because their poll showed otherwise. Yeah, he's going to pull a full Trump. Yeah, NT Biden. Oh, yi. This is... there's not enough of this, like, style of cope, by the way, to carry him across the finish line, just so you guys understand. Like, this is so chalked.
Look, George, think of it this way. You've heard me say...
Gay January 6th incoming? Yeah, dude, they're gonna... Well, the last one was gay, too. Brandon Straka was there, the guy who left the Democratic Party.
Before, I think the United States and the world is at an inflection point. The things that happen in the next several years are going to determine what the next 6-7 decades look like. And who's going to be able to hold NATO together like me? Who's going to be able to be in a position where I'm able to keep the Pacific Basin in a position where we're at least checkmating China now?
Checkmating? Checking in.
What up, China?
How you going?
That's another thing that, like, Trump was, again, this goes back to, like, the immigration conversation. Being reactionary towards China in your foreign policy is the Republican position. Democrats cannot win on that front either, okay? You can be an elderly statesman and talk about, like, you know, cooler heads prevailing and that you need to take the necessary precautions against China, even though they're a great competitor, blah, blah, blah. But you can't be like, I'm the one who's going to take down Xi Jinping or whatever. You can't say that. That's the Republican position. No one is going to go, yes, I'm voting for the Democratic president because they are going to be the ones that kill immigrants. I'm voting for the Democratic president because they are the ones who are going to actually keep China in check. I don't think that this is like a real confidence builder for the Democratic ticket at all. Okay? It's so stupid. It is yet another unironic flub, both bad policy and bad politics from the Democratic Party.
Who's gonna do that? Who has that reach? Who knows all these? We're gonna have, I guess, a good way to judge me is you're gonna have now the NATO.
By the way, 22 minutes in, and he's also devolving. Like he is. He is now melting, okay? Look, he started off strong, did the weird face, but at least he was, like, more coherent. Now he's like...
to the United States next week. Come listen.
He's like, all might, dude. He's losing all of his power. Sorry for all the, you know, for the 8 My Hero Academia fans in here. He's like, all might at the end of his, like, power cycle. You know what I mean? He can only run it. He can only run the character for, like... He can only run the All My character for like 20 minutes, and he's like at the end of his juice now.
What they say?
Don't say Mid Hero Academia. Season 5 is incredible. Season 6 is even darker. I love it. Okay.
Is this hentai?
No, it's not hentai. It's anime.
Thank you.
That's it. Wait, what?
How did it end? I want to see that again.
Who's gonna do that? Who has that reach?
They cut the interview.
Yeah, they have no cuts.
I guess that's a cut.
No, he said I didn't touch him.
Is you're going to have now a NATO conference here in the United States next week. Come listen.
That's pretty cool.
See what they say.
Mr. President, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
That was a cut there. Though.
ABC News also offered a one-on-one interview to Donald Trump after the debate. He declined. Let's bring in our political team for what they're hearing. Let me start out with our chief Washington correspondent, John Carl. And John, you watched
that one in the middle.
You watched the interview. You've been talking to people all across Washington. What are you hearing?
Well, George, look, Biden looked better and certainly more coherent than he looked during the debate.
I mean, yeah, but there, he looked really bad in the debate. Yeah. It's like, that's a low bar to set. You know what I mean? He looked a little bit better than the debate. Still not great.
There's nothing in this interview that is calming nerves of jittery Democrats who fear that Joe Biden is on a trajectory to lose this race, to lose to Donald Trump. In fact, for some of those people, the interview is raising new concerns. Particularly,
okay, the interview just happened. What do you mean it's raising new concerns? How do they know? Yeah. How do they know?
To the host of the interview, he was like, I need to go to the doctor right now and talk about look at Biden.
The fact that he is unwilling or unaware of the fact that he is in a dire situation here regarding the campaign, that he is looting.
Yeah, because he's demented, dog. That's why he like doesn't even understand that he's underwater.
In the view of many Democrats, and frankly, in the polls, you cited that he is losing to Donald Trump. And there was one question that you asked where his answer is particularly, I believe, alarming to some of those Democrats. You asked him how he will feel in January if he has lost to Donald Trump and all that he has warned would happen came to pass. And this was his answer. He said,
oh, this is the worst
I'll
part,
feel
yeah.
as long as I gave it my all and did the best job I know I can do, that's what this is about. One prominent ally of the...
Yeah, I know. They're trying to clean it up a little bit. No, sir. He specifically said goodest. I'm the goodest boy.
The president simply responded to me, wow, when I asked about that question. So the bottom line here, there was no...
The White House actually disputed that he said goodest. Goodest job or goodest job? The White House wants a word. Wait, what?
But none of those make sense.
What is a good-ass job?
Oh, that's Australian. It's like good-ass.
Yeah, you say good-ass job.
Good-ass job.
Yeah, but this Biden is not saying
Or you say a good-ass job.
Yeah, good-ass job. ABC News tweaked this transcript of an intriguing moment in his Friday interview with the president after the Biden administration and news outlets raised questions. This is the victory. This is the path to victory.
Yeah.
You don't understand. No, the White House is killing it right now, dude. Oh my God. Yeah, he's a good ad job. That's what he said. ABC News adjusted his initial transcript of a much discussed moment in the President Biden's Friday interview at the White House. Oh my God, it's so bad. Oh my God, this is what we're doing? Oh, this is so bad. The moment occurred after the end of Mr. Biden's interview when George Stephanopoulos asked the president how he would feel if he stayed in the presidential race and was defeated by former President Donald J. Trump. I'll feel as long as I gave it my all and I did the goodest job I know I can do.
But good as is not any better.
I did the What's good the... as job and I know I can do. Like, as good as a job. As good as a job is not good as job.
Good as job.
What the f***?
It would be really fun to be on his campaign also, and like try to come up with the ways to save him.
He was actually quoting someone from the 80s movie. You know, he's got a good memory.
The moment occurred towards the end of Mr. Biden's interview, I feel as long as I gave him my all and I did the good-ass job I know I can do.
Good-ass job.
This is so psychotic because, like, their defense of this, like, as good as a job as I can do is, like, four additional words, bro. He did not say those words. So if your defense is, no, he said I'll do as good as job as I can do, then you're still failing.
Yeah.
Like, that actually... low-key makes it sound even worse, as a matter of fact. How is that possible?
It's also not relevant. Like, are you denying he can't speak? Like, it's very obvious. You're nitpicking this one sentence. No, and be like, this was right. This one was fine.
This is so bad, bro. It's so bad. By Saturday afternoon, the quote in Network's online transcript had changed slightly. I'll feel as long as I gave him my all and I did the good-ass job as I know I can do. That's what this is about.
That's actually worse than goodest.
He didn't say that! Why is this a moment of contest? Like, why is this being contested? Like, also, maybe they think this is like a good way to neutralize the fact that he said, oh, I'll get a participation trophy, even though like the entire narrative has been democracy's on the ballot. And now instead of democracy's on the ballot, what's on the ballot is like, you know, Joe Biden trying his hardest and still losing.
It's hurting me.
Timestamp the rest of ABC's Powerhouse Roundtable. Multiple reporters and ex-DNC chair. They re-aired the interview this week with George.
Our thanks to the president for his time. ABC News also offered an interview.
Okay, hold on. Let's get back to this good-ass job.
Nothing in this interview that will force Joe Biden out of the race. There was no, you know, major thing that will convince him or any of his allies. I believe they have to go. But there's also nothing in this interview that will calm the nerves of Democrats who are saying it is time for him to get out.
Martha Raddatz, the president is talking to a lot of people, but he appears to be listening to a very tight circle.
Stretching her eye.
A very tight circle. And administration officials I have spoken to said that very tight inner circle is telling them he can win, that he needs to keep going. This, of course, includes his wife, Jill, who they said is lashing out at those who...
Connery's pants. He's literally trying his best. Lamau, some people will always be haters. You're right.
He's
I'm
doing
sorry.
The goodest job.
I apologize.
Good
he's doing
ass
his
job.
He's good doing ass. As good as a job. Well, he's doing as good as job. He's doing good as job. They'll put that on t-shirt. That's a winning slogan. I'm doing a good as job. That's
him to get out of the race. This was a Joe Biden pumped up on his inner circle, telling him that again and again. They think he will have many opportunities, but those not in the inner circle say this will also expose him to a great deal of risk. And George, I've talked to a few people too, and texting with a few people as well on the Hill. They say it was better than they expected, wasn't as bad.
I told you guys that he wasn't gonna have like massive flubs, and he didn't have like ginormous flubs in the sense that like he did in the debate. But if there was no way to salvage the situation unless he became an entirely different person, unless the Illuminati cloned him and brought forward like a sexy ass clone. He's just like wearing a fucking flowy ass silk shirt. His pectorals are glistening in the sun. He's toned and tanned, you know?
He got
and
a
he's
tan, just like, at least.
Yeah,
he did get a tan.
Yeah.
And he's just like super competent, super with it. He like basically became like a Gavin Newsom type, then maybe. But that's not going to happen. The Illuminati is asleep at the wheel, okay? He just looked less worse. Still bad, just less worse.
Bad as they expected, but that's a pretty low.
Stop asking me if this Turkish Chicagoan can meet me in the DNC if I come to the DNC, okay? You have literally spammed it nonstop. Okay, I will be in Chicago for the DNC. Just stop asking, please. Oh my God, you've asked 1,000 times, dude. Holy. Even if I were to say yes originally, now I'm a little scared, okay? I feel like you're going to kill me now.
Oh, bar, George.
Chill.
And Mary, Bruce, what are you hearing from the White House?
George, the White House tonight reacting in one word, strong. Look, you heard the president there, and his team strongly do believe that this is all being overblown, strong. That Joe Biden has been underestimated and written off before, only to come back strong and win. They believe if he can continue to do interviews like this, if he can continue to get out in front of the American people, that this too shall pass.
That's
but
crazy.
The president there truly did.
Yeah, I said this before. They are... Let me know if you want press pass for the march on the DNC. No, I don't want press pass for the march on the DNC. I want press passes for the DNC. If I'm marching on the DNC, it's going to be to say I love the DNC. Okay, come on. Stop the bags, Cinemarxism and everybody else. Jesus Christ. I love the Republican Party for the duration of me trying to go to Milwaukee, and I love the Democratic Party when I go to Chicago. Okay, please stop, you know, stop saying stuff like that. Okay, I am trying to get press pass for both, and they are very... very aggro about it, okay? I'm the goodest boy, and I think the president did a good-ass job and is doing a good-ass job. He said good-ass job, and that makes sense to me now, okay? Anyway, also, this is great. This is good, man. He is literally trying to be helpful. No, hold on. We'll talk about it offline, okay? Chill out. No public statements against the Democratic Party or the Republican Party. We like both here, okay? I'm just an extreme centrist. I like both of the parties. Anyway, I'm doing a good as job. Beyond that, shit, what was I going to say? There's so much momentum here. There's so much movement. Connor is here. I'm trying to like rush through this coverage. But so that we can have Connor come in and we can pick up we can pick like a audition thing, or not an audition, an auction thing. Well, see, I'm Biden. I'm Brandon.
It's happening.
Dude, watching, I love him so much. I'm sundowning. That's how it is. All right, let's keep going.
To grasp the severity of this moment, the magnitude of that growing chorus of concern from Democrats. He dismissed that, dismissed the trends that we are seeing in the polls. But what we are hearing from Democrats isn't concern about one bad night. They are concerned that Joe Biden doesn't have what it takes not only to continue governing, but that he has what it takes to win. But the president is adamant that he is still the best one to take on Donald Trump. And you heard there, he clearly doesn't want to entertain the possibility that Democrats may come to him and urge him to step aside, saying only the Lord Almighty could convince him of that, George.
And that is the key question right now. So I want to go to our senior congressional correspondent, Rachel Scott. The most important audience probably right now for the president and the White House are those Democratic leaders on Capitol Hill. And there has been some ferment in the last couple of hours.
Exactly, George. And they were watching tonight, I can tell you that. In fact, just minutes before your interview aired, you had a fourth Democratic lawmaker come forward in the House and call on the president to step aside. That was Congressman Mike Quigley of Illinois. I have talked to a number of Democrats that were glued in watching this interview. One Democratic senator telling me that the president is clear-eyed about the demand.
Share with the class.
No.
Share with the class.
We're talking about you, Hasan.
Quigley's from a cartoon.
We're trying to figure out who's Quigley.
Quigley. Come on. Someone knows Quigley. Is it Powerpuff Girls? No. Where's Quigley?
Answer the president sees the urgency of the moment and the importance of defeating Donald Trump. But others say that they still have concerns, that the dam hasn't broken tonight, but the bleeding has not stopped either. Another Democrat telling me better, but not sure that it's enough, that they need more than one interview, more than 22 minutes to...
How much consent is being manufactured for Biden? No, there isn't. I'm going to be honest with you guys. I think the otherwise liberal media sees the polls, sees the writing on the wall, and is either A, genuinely worried about Biden's chances and like are basically turning on him entirely. Like he has lost the media support completely. They are cooking him with like Hasanabi 2020 ferocity. Okay. They are doing shit that I was doing in 2020 when I was like, dude, he's so old. What the fuck are we doing here? Which is surprising because he was old back then as well. And the media definitely carried him across the finish line. Meanwhile, his circle is getting smaller and smaller within the Democratic Party. His loyalists are getting smaller and smaller. And everybody's out for blood. They're in a feeding frenzy at this moment. So they know, one, it's the worst situation overall for Biden because, like, one, I think partially... they are worried about Biden being so old that like Trump is going to cook him. Okay. And two, I think that there is a lot of clicks for shitting on Biden. And that creates a unique set of circumstances where they will keep pushing that button over and over again. It is now the narrative. The narrative has been set that he is very old. So they're going to keep hitting that line. I mean, dude, this full on interview got 1.1 million views. Like, the interview got watched by a lot of people. I think you got like 8 million people watching it and shit. Like, it's not good.
To prove that the president has the stamina to continue in this race and defeat Donald Trump, a different Democrat putting it to me this way, George, there's no question that Biden must win.
You've been living in my house when I wasn't here.
Stealing food from Hasan.
You've been living in my house for like the past 7 days while I wasn't here. Why would I ever tell you?
Because I saw it on a pile there with all the other illicit stuff you have here, and I thought there might be like something in there. You know,
he asked if I could have. He could have a Mentos gum, like. Like, he's been living in my house for 7 days. I wasn't even here. Like, this, you think that's a bridge too far for our friendship? Yeah,
I'm trying to cover up all the horrible things I did here. Yeah. And I'm like being extra.
That's
nice.
Like me yesterday asking for a Zin.
Yeah.
That I haven't been doing it the whole time anyway.
Yeah. Oh, you've been slamming them? You've been slamming the Zins?
You're a monster.
Yeah.
Election, but he will not be in a position to stop a movement. And tonight, George, that movement against him is growing.
Well, and that's what I want to get into with John Carl in a little more detail. John, we talked about Mark Warner, senator from Virginia. A battleground state, the Democrats have won the past few elections, but appears to be more in play right now. He's circulating that letter.
Yeah, and I've spoken to colleagues of Senator Warner's who have spoken to him about this. It's a serious effort. Senator Warner's concerns. He has real concerns about whether or not Biden can beat Donald Trump. He thinks it's come to a pivotal moment for the party and for the nation. And his concerns are not alone. Frankly, a lot of other Democrats have been unwilling to speak publicly because they want Biden to come to this on his own. And they're concerned that coming out and speaking publicly will only backfire. But it is a widespread relief among Democrats.
And Rachel Scott, Hakeem Jeffries, the Democratic leader in the House, has now called House Democrats for a Zoom meeting on Sunday.
And this will be coming right before Democrats head back to Capitol Hill. That is going to be pivotal. I'm told that the Democratic leader has been measured in his approach, really trying to calm the nerves and give the president the space to make this decision. But he is getting quite an earful from House Democrats who have concerns about if the president can defeat Donald Trump this November, nights. George.
Not just one bad night, two bad nights. Come on. That's all this is. Another bad night. I mean, everybody chill out. Just another bad night. There's going to be probably more of them, but who cares?
Chris, you had that one-word response from the White House, the campaign weighing in now as well.
Oh, George, the campaign understandably is eager to turn this back to Donald Trump and back to the issues. Look, their thinking on all of this is that this shouldn't be about, you know, performance, that this is about the issues and the substance. They want, you know, as the president tried to do there in your interview, they want to hammer what the president has accomplished, what he could do going forward, and are obviously very eager to make sure to highlight what is at stake here. The challenge is that so much of that has now been overshadowed by these questions about the president's age, and that is what Democrats are deeply concerned about, that the messaging here is being lost in the way it is being delivered. The question is whether or not the president's interview tonight, whether or not his appearances that we have seen in the last few days and will see in the days to come, whether that is going to be enough to quell any of this concern and get Democrats back on track.
The fact that all of us face Martha Raddatz, none of us can stop the clock.
Stop the clock. And this is about age. That's exactly what that's about. And this will dominate this campaign. Aging is not like a broken bone. It doesn't get better. So there is an opportunity every time he goes out, every time Joe Biden goes out.
Age is like a broken bone. Age is not like a broken bone. It doesn't get better. Damn, I'm kind of mad. That's a banger line. I'm mad I didn't think of it first. Like, I mean, I've been making the same exact joke for a while, but that's like a way more poetic way to put it, you know? And when they want to be, they can actually, when they want to be, the media can actually do their job, and it's annoying.
It's so disconcerting that I've seen it happen in like a week, you know, like overnight. I'm just like, what have you been doing this entire time?
It's very, very frustrating that they didn't do this before and only now. Are they attempting to do it? And it's like, where was this energy in 2020, man? You guys are such assholes. You. Yeah, they were too busy talking about how Bernie Sanders is going to lead an intifada in America and execute billionaires and shit. Oh, why are we not getting political commentary from foreign correspondent C-Dog Va? Because I don't think he wants to do that. And I'm not going to force his hand to do such a thing. I feel bad, though. Like, I brought him in here, and I'm over here talking about Brandon. We might do a little break. 13.23. We might do a little break to do the Connor segment in here. I'm weighing my chicken, 13.23 ounces.
And he cuts it with glass and sells it for more.
What? Like cocaine?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
It's the only time I've ever seen those scales here.
Oh, that's what you were making a drug joke because I have a weed scale.
Yeah. That's awesome.
I think it's more important to hear about Veterans Affairs in this race. Yeah, I'm a protein pervert.
That he will show his age. I mean, he said he is not more frail. You ask him, you told him, you say, watch me. Everyone is watching, and believe me, they are going to be watching even more closely as we go forward. George.
It is funny. I mean, I do feel vindicated.
Thanks to all of you.
And
thanks.
It is kind of funny to hear like the ABC senior political correspondent panel basically reflect all of the things that I've been saying about the situation. It's like kind of an odd. Making sure the restaurant's not undercutting you. No, man. I just want to...
Excuse me. It's not 130 grams of chicken.
No, I'm just trying to figure out how much protein I'm putting in my bod. I'm the pro goat.
I don't think it's gratifying, though. I think it's offensive seeing them do it.
You know, it makes me feel like they're up to something different. I'm like, what's happening now?
Like, who are you replacing him?
Why are you saying it now?
An even older guy.
Yeah, that's what
Jimmy Carter. Welcome back. Welcome back, Jimmy Carter. OCD calorie counting is ruining your life? No, it's not.
Look who suddenly
came. That's funny, though, because I get a lot of, like MAGA right-wing Twitter, and they're still claiming that, like, the mainstream media is running cover for Joe Biden.
Yeah, no,
yeah.
While pointing to how hard they're cooking him too.
Yeah.
They're like, damn, even ABC's saying this, but they're still running cover for him. It's like, dude, what do you mean? You're watching the footage.
Yeah.
You're watching their commentary. They sound like they're ripping into him.